Welcome to the channel of Marco Direct. My name is Tim Holweg and I'm going to be your host for today's video. Today we're going to talk about, as you can probably tell, we're going to talk about developing black and white film. So here on the table right now we have pretty much everything you need for developing your own black and white film. First of all, I want to touch on black and white film developing. So what do you need? You need a room. You need a clean environment, preferably your kitchen or your bathroom. You don't really need a dedicated darkroom. I mean, it can be handy, but if you're starting out and if you're starting to develop black and white film at home, you mostly do it in the kitchen as I do, or in the bathroom. So either way, you need a sink, you need a source of water, and that's pretty much all you need. Why should you develop your own black and white film? It's simply because now you can really take advantage of taking full control over the outcome of your images, because each film has its characteristics. Each developer, for example, Rolly offers different developers. This right here is more of a lower grain developer, which is the Rolly Super Grain. And then also each film and developer combination has a unique look. And then also the way you agitate, how long you develop, what temperature at, and the dilution has all big influences on the final look of the product, which is the negative. And now you can really take control over that. Because if you give it to a lab to develop, usually they use whatever they feel like is right for you. And so now you can really see, well, do I want less grain, do I want more grain, do I want higher contrast? And so you can really adjust it either way you want it, and so you can take full control over the outcome. Now I want to briefly talk about what you need for developing your own black and white film. It's pretty simple and it's a lot easier compared to developing color film, because with black and white film you don't have to care as much about the temperature as with color film. You still need to, but then again it's not as temperature critical. Now I want to talk about the things you need to develop your own black and white film. Of course you need a finished roll of film. What I usually do is use this Kaiser film retriever, because I usually roll in my rolls the whole way so that there's no film sticking outside. And so I use this tool. There's a tutorial up on how to use this, so just go in the description down below and you can check that out, how that works. And then you also need a developing tank, which is pretty much your main part of the developing. So in this case we have a Patterson Universal, which is a part of the Super System Type 4. This is a very good tank to get started, because this can take up to 2 rolls, and you can also develop only 1 roll by just inserting in the lower roll, but we will touch on that later. And there also is a full video on the different Patterson tanks that are out there, so if you want to check that out, also the link is in the description down below. Again, this is what I would recommend anybody to get started in film photography, because you can also develop 120 film with it and up to 2 rolls of 35mm film, which makes this very versatile. Now we want to talk about some other stuff. So what you're going to need is a changing bag. This is very handy if you're developing in your kitchen, in your bathroom, or wherever, and you don't really have access to getting complete darkness, because when developing film you really need 100% pitch black, because if there's a safe light, if there's any light, your film will get those patterns off on the film and your film won't be exposed correctly. And so this changing bag can be very handy, and I use it all the time pretty much. This is by Patterson. This is a larger one. There are different sizes available, but I just prefer the larger one because there's more space to move around. You simply go ahead and insert your arms on the sides of the changing bag, and then you can just go ahead and put your film into the developing tank. And once you close the lid, the developing tank is light sealed, so you can go ahead, take it out in the light and start your developing. Now I want to talk about the other stuff you need. So of course you need measuring cups and all of that. Then you also need those funnels, because with some chemistry you're not allowed to dump it in the sink. It depends on your country, on your region, but with us at least you're not allowed to put in the fixer, and also not the developer. What I do is put it in larger tanks and then bring it to the people who can take proper care of that. Also, what I use are those bottles, so I usually pre-mix my stop bath and my fixer, but we will go into chemistry later and explain when to use what. But I will pre-mix that and put it in those bottles. Usually in here I have some distilled water for the final wash, but I will be explaining that all of that later. What you're also going to need is a timer. So I usually use a timer. I prefer that over using, let's say, your smartphone or your tablet, because you are messing around with chemicals and also sometimes your hands get wet, and so this is really a lot easier, and I mean it does the job. And I also use, of course, you need a pair of scissors to cut the film. You need a spoon just to mix the chemistry. You also need thermometers, so I have various thermometers to be able to measure the chemistry temperature, the water temperature, for that to work properly. Because with most developers, you're mostly looking at around 20 degrees Celsius, and then with all of the other chemicals, it's all the same. So therefore, black and white 20 degrees is really handy. With color film, you usually have like 39 degrees, which is a lot harder to retain than 20 degrees, which is right around room temperature. So then you can also use those film clips. There are special dedicated film clips out there like these, who are weighted at the very bottom. So they have one which is not weighted, which goes on the upper side, and then one which is weighted, which goes on the lower side, so that the film can dry evenly and can hang up really nicely. I really like to use them because they allow me to the film to dry flat and also to dry even, so therefore I use those. Then now I want to talk about the chemistry. So the chemistry, the most decisive part on the whole look of the film pretty much, is the developer. For developer, there are various different options. For example, this one right here from Rohle is a super grain developer, which is more of a developer for finer grain. There are other developers who introduce more grain to the film, or who introduce more contrast, but it all depends on the film, because a big part is how the film works together with the developer. So each film and developer combination has its own unique look. What you're also going to need is a stop bath, so this stops your development, because developer is your first chemistry, and then you're going to go ahead with the stop bath, and this is here to stop your development. Usually it takes around 1 to 2 minutes, and this is just for the film, that the developing solution gets off the film, and you're now prepared for your fixer. And in the fixing step, which is right here, this is the fixer, which is also usually 20 degrees, and you fix approximately to the times that your film has. The fixer takes off the silver from the film and makes it unsensitive to light. So after the fixing process, you can take your film out in light and you can see what images you got, or if you got images. And then your last step, which is optional, is a wetting agent. So I use this because when you use the wetting agent, you allow the film to dry more evenly, there are no watermarks. And what I also do is I usually pre-mix a solution with the wetting agent and distilled water, because this really gives me the optimal outcome of ingredients in the water I don't want, and also the wetting agent which enables the film to dry evenly. So those are the main four chemicals you need for your developing process. In reality, you really need those three. The wetting agent is optional, but I really enjoy it, because sometimes if you have for example, you have access to kind of bad water, it's not as clean as you would like, it's really handy to get the wetting agent and distilled water for your last wash, let it sit in there, and so therefore this is a great option for that. So now that we've touched on all the things you need to develop your own black and white film, I now want to touch on the specific steps you need to execute to develop your own black and white film. First of all, you're going to need to see which film you got, because each film developer combination has its own times, its own dilutions, and so therefore make sure which film you got. Then you also need to see if you have pushed or pulled the film. So there's again also a video up on where I explain what is pushing and what is pulling and what effects has it on developing times. So in a nutshell, if you want to push your film, you for example expose a 200 speed film at 400 or 800, so you underexpose it by one or two stops. And then in the development part, you overdevelop for the negatives to be developed properly. This will have effects on your look, so usually it introduces more contrast and more grain. Pulling is pretty much again the complete opposite, so it will introduce less contrast. This is very handy in higher contrast situations, and you will also overexpose the film, because you're now shooting it at 100 or 50, so you will overexpose it by one or two stops. And then in the developing part, you will develop shorter compared to developing it properly, and so therefore the film will come out properly. So this is again just a quick touch on pushing and pulling, but if you have shot the film either at stock or at push and pull speeds, usually the manufacturer gives out different times for different developers. Also on the bottle right here, you have different times for different developers and different films, and so therefore this is very handy. You can also visit websites like Massive Dev Chart or filmdev.org. On filmdev.org, it's a really good page, because they also have examples on combinations between films and developer. You can see what dilutions they used, what times, and all of that, and you can also see the final outcome. On Massive Dev Chart, you have huge charts on illustrating which developer goes with which film, how long, and all of that. So therefore, those sites are a great resource for that. If you have now finished on doing a little research, because you have to do that beforehand, of course, on how to Yeah, on which times you need for a developer and film combination. You usually also sometimes try to figure that out a little bit. You experiment, because this of course gives you a very neutral look, but if you're going for more contrast or more grain, you have to develop it a little bit differently. So therefore it all depends on your preferences.
In the following, I'm going to explain to you how to load your film onto the reel. You have to pay in mind that this has to happen in complete darkness, otherwise your film will be ruined. So again, no safe light, nothing. This is why I recommend using the changing bag, because with a changing bag you don't need a dedicated darkroom, and also you can do that under daylight, so it's very handy for that. So on the table right now, as you can see, is our developing tank. This is again the Patterson tank I'm also using. So in here are the two reels, and on those plastic reels you will have to load your film onto them. On the left hand side we got our film retriever, which is a very nice tool if you want to get your film out of the canister again, which I'm going to explain you how to use now. I usually rewind my films all the way, because then I know which films I have previously exposed and which I didn't. So in this case this tool comes in handy. So what you're simply going to do is insert it into the film this way, as I've been illustrating in the video, and then you will just simply rotate it clockwise until you hear a little click. That's when the We are very end of the film slips the tongue of the film retriever, and then you simply rotate it counterclockwise as I'm doing right now. Then you pull out the film retriever, and here you have your film leader. So now you are ready for cutting the film properly. You have to cut the film very specifically, as you can see right now. So I would recommend it to cut it round and to cut it off really nicely. You can do that in daylight, because this is a part where which is yeah either way going to be exposed. Now I'm going to show you how to load the film onto the reel with a Patterson reel. It's really easy. It features the autoload system. It has those two ball bearings which you can see on the side, and you simply need to pull your film under the bigger plastic part which you can see in the video, and then you just simply pull it over the ball bearings, which is essential, and then you start to rotate it. Just as a disclaimer, this has to happen in complete darkness, otherwise your film will be ruined. With a Patterson it's a fairly easy process. You have to take out your film, either you have to open up your canister beforehand with a bottle opener, or you can go ahead and pull out the film itself from the canister, which I usually do in the darkroom, because then it don't really get messed up in my changing bag. And so then the film is onto the reel and we can start to insert it into the developing tank. It's very important to notice that if you're only developing one roll of film, you of course have to put the film you're developing on the lower roll, because otherwise there won't be any chemicals, because you are using less chemicals compared to developing two films, and you're then saving some chemistry, and so therefore the film has to be on the top and the lower part, which you can see right here. So it's in the lower part, the thicker part also goes down, and then you just simply put it inside of your developing tank. You put on the lid, and now it is light tight. So this is the point where you can go ahead and put out the developing tank into daylight, and you can start the developing process. In the following, I'm going to illustrate how to mix the chemicals and how to develop the film. On the bottom of the Patterson tanks you have your volumes. So they are the different volume, 35 mm, 290 mL. For two you then need 580 mL, and for one 120 film you need 500 mL of solution. On the bottle itself from the developer you can see here are different times, and also the times for per each per dilution. So you got your time for your dilution and for your each individual films. You can also look that up on Massive Depth Chart or on filmdepth.org, as I've already said. So those are the options you have right here. Then you're going to prepare some water. In this case we need 20 degrees Celsius water, so make sure that it's really 20 degrees Celsius spot on. You can also use that water for the fixer and for the stop bath, but we will go into mixing that later. So as you can see, we are at 20 degrees, which is our optimal developing and also other chemistry temperature. The developer, as you can see, we are using in this case is the Rolly Super Grain, and we are using a Superpen 200 film. So we are using 1.1+9 dilution. Here you can see the different dilutions for each volume, so you can check that out if you're interested in developing your own films and also have a 1+9 dilution. Then we're going to start to mix the chemistry and the water. Again, 20 degrees Celsius water. Then we're going to mix the developer. What I would suggest you to do afterwards is, after you've mixed the water and developer, go ahead and put in your thermometer and really see if that's 20 degrees spot on. You can also cool down or warm the water if needed. So I'm going to mix that, And after that, we are going to put that in this bottle for it to be prepared for our later steps. Now we come into the stop bath. Stop bath is 1+19 dilution, 1 minute. And here you also got our different dilutions for each individual. If you're going to for 1 or 2 or 120 film. In this case, we're also going to mix it, and it's an indicator stop bath. So after it, it cannot be used anymore. It will change its color. So right now it's pretty pink. And so we're going to mix that with, again, 20 degrees Celsius water. If you have warmer water, you should do the stop bath shorter. If you have colder water, do it longer. Also, we will put that in the bottle for it to be prepared for later. Our third step is mixing the fixer. So the fixer will take off the silver from the film and will make it unsensitive to light. In this case, we're using 1+9 dilution. You can use all different dilutions from 1+5, 1+7, 1+9. Higher dilutions will mean shorter fixing time. With the fixer, you can do a simple test and you take a strip of unexposed film, put it inside of your fixer in the working solution, and then take the time until the film is clear and until the film doesn't get any clearer. Double that amount of time and you have your fixing time. So you can also figure that out by yourself, but some manufacturers also suggest the time. In this case, we are right around 5 to 6 minutes with this fixer. Now we come into the developing part itself, where I will show you how to develop and what to do. In this case, we need 6 minutes for our SuperPan 200 film at 200 ISO, developed with the Rolly Supergrain developer. Just prepare your agitation stick and also your lid. Pour in the developer, set your timer beforehand, and then once all the developer is inside, start the timer, as you can see, and then you will just rotate with the stick until the first minute is over. So this is what I do, and then after the first minute I put on the lid, and then every time the timer hits the 1 minute mark or 30 seconds mark, I'm going to go ahead and agitate the tank for right around 2 to 3 times, which results mostly in right around 5 seconds. So once that timer hits the 1 minute mark, I'm going to start to agitate for around 5 seconds. And then, which is very important, tap the developing tank on the table for any air bubbles to loosen, which is very, very important. After the developing is finished, make sure to pour in your developer back into the bottle or in your dump bottle, either way. And then we're going to go ahead with the stop bath. The stop bath takes 1 minute according to the manufacturer's times right here. So we're going to insert it, and then after it hits 1 minute, we're going to pour it back into the bottle. And if the because it's an indicator stop bath, we will see if it is finished and if it cannot be used anymore. But usually I use it for, let's say, 5 to 10 films, and then I just replace it, because then there's developer inside, and so therefore just get a fresh one. Now we're going to go into the fixing part. The fixing part right now takes 6 minutes. So I've been going for 1+9 dilution, which I mostly do, and then I fix for 6 minutes. I'm going to again do the same procedure as with the developing, where I'm going to agitate for the first minute with the stick. Then I'm going to put on the lid, agitate every 30 seconds for 5 seconds. So this is my agitation method for both fixing and also for the developing part itself. With the stop bath, I usually just use the stick, because it either way just takes 1 minute. I'm going to agitate pretty much either 30 seconds or all of the time, because it's not really a time critical procedure. Then I'm just going to put on the lid again in our fixing process right now, and then once the timer hits the 30 seconds mark, I'm going to agitate for the first time, and so on and so forth. The agitation also depends on your preferences. Some do it a little bit shorter, some do it a little bit longer. It all depends on how you want your film to look. You can experiment here a little bit, but right around 5 seconds is usually a time which gives a neutral look to the film. After it's finished, make sure to put the fixer back inside of the bottle and really take care of that, because there is silver inside and that should not go into the sink. Now we come into the washing part. I am doing an active wash for 10 minutes. So this is also not really time critical, but 10 minutes is really a time where I see that the chemistry is away from the film. So I'm going to actively dump the water again and again, going to agitate a little bit. This is also the time where I mostly do my wetting agent. So the wetting agent, you can see the volumes right here. The wetting agent is there for the film to dry evenly and not to leave any water marks after the film has dried completely. So this has a dilution of 1+100, so it's not a lot of wetting agent you have to put in. So here we have our waiting agent prepared, and then once that timer hits again after 10 minutes of wash, it's not really time critical, you can also do longer. Of course, we're going to put in the wetting agent. The wetting agent is also far from being time critical, so I usually keep it in for, let's say, 1 to 3 hours in that range. And then I'm going to hang up the film to dry. So as you can see, I'm just going to put in my wetting agent. I usually use distilled water in this step because it's really the last wash, the last thing that's going to touch your film. And so therefore, I'm using distilled water just to get the best results possible. Now we are finished with the developing part, we are going to go back into the studio and we're going to talk about further steps you're going to have to take now.
So now that we are through the whole developing process, I want to go ahead and explain the further steps. So what you're going to do next is you're going to simply open up your tank. Your film is now ready and able to be taken out in light. So what you're going to do next is you're going to just take the film reel your film is on. And then to open up the film reel with the Patterson tanks, you just simply have to over-rotate it until it's loose, and then you just have to let loose, and that's pretty much it. It's fairly easy. And then the next step is very important. You shouldn't touch the film on the emulsion. You can touch it on the side, or you can touch it on the very beginning or very end, because there usually is some dead space, because you need to put the film inside the camera, and also at the end there's some dead space. The next step is to go ahead and use the film clips. They are very nice because they are also weighted, so you usually put the non-weighted one at the top, and then you take the weighted one and put it at the very bottom, and so therefore this will enable your film to dry very flat and very evenly. So now that we've taken your film outside of the reel, we're going to prepare it for the drying process. What we're going to use in this case is a film wiper. I know a lot of people don't like to use those, but my suggestion is to put them in warm or hot water beforehand so that the rubber really softens up, and then just simply put it for a little while in the wetting agent for it to soak up the fluid. And then you just simply go ahead and you shouldn't press it. You just simply should really gently push it over like 2 to 3 times, and that's pretty much it. Most of the water will be gone from the film, and the film just has to dry. And for that, I'm using those film clips. They are coming in weighted and non-weighted versions, so you put the non-weighted version at the very top, and then you just go ahead and put the weighted one on the bottom, and you can go ahead and hang up your film to dry. Where should you hang up your film to dry? My suggestion is to go ahead and hang it up in the shower, because the shower really is the place in your home where there's the least amount of dust. I wouldn't suggest you, of course, in the meantime to do like any crazy hairspray stuff or so, but still, just go ahead and hang it up in the shower. It's pretty dust free, and also you can usually hang up something in the shower, which is fairly easy, and so therefore the shower is the perfect place to hang up your film to dry. Also, you can use any other rooms that may be unused. Concerning the time the film needs to dry, it all depends on your room temperature. I wouldn't suggest you hanging them up in a very humid or very hot room, so therefore just like room temperature 20 degrees Celsius is perfectly fine for hanging the film up to dry. I usually hang them up for a whole night so that they are 100% dry, and then you can go ahead and archive them. With archiving, you just go ahead and cut it, put it inside your negative sleeves, and then you can proceed with further steps like scanning or printing as you would like. Just to summarize it, I think it's a great experience and also a great process to develop your own black and white film. You now have complete control over the outcome. You are the one who's responsible. You can select the film, the chemicals, the way you process it, meaning agitation, developing time, temperature, and all of that. So all of the variables that go into this process are now under your control, and I think it's a very good process, and also it can save you some money, because comparing it, developing your own film is fairly cheap. You just have to pay for the chemicals. At first, of course, you need to get all of the things I've been talking about, but it's not too much, and once you have that set, you don't really need anything new. And so therefore, I think you can also save a lot of money, especially when you're scanning or printing yourself, and I think it's a great option to really get the most out of your negatives. I really hope you enjoyed this tutorial. If you have any questions on black and white film developing or anything pretty much in general, make sure to go in the description down below and ask your question there. Also, if you have any suggestions or would like to see any further videos, also make sure to go and put that in the description down below. I'm very happy to hear that. Thank you guys for watching, and I hope you have a good day, and see you. Bye.